Welcome and thanks for listening to the Big Ideas for Better Places podcast today. If you like what you hear, we encourage you to please leave us a rating and a review on iTunes or wherever you're listening to this. This really helps other folks find out about the podcast, our great guests, and the wisdom that they have to share. So without further ado, on to today's episode.
Please listen carefully.
Welcome to the Big Ideas for Better Places podcast from CityWorks Expo. My name is Brad Stevens, and I'll be your host today. It's my absolute pleasure to introduce you to our guests, Ms. Michelle Sanaya, co-founder and executive director of the Laneway Project. How are you doing today?
Doing pretty well, thanks.
Good. Now, where are you guys based again?
We're based in Toronto.
Okay, which is...
Toronto, Ontario, Canada.
Which is will be very interesting. I talked on Monday. I did a podcast with a gentleman from Sidewalk Labs, which I imagine you're very intrigued to see kind of what happens with all of that stuff up there.
Yeah, definitely. That's going to be a really interesting development in the city. I'm excited to see how that unfolds.
I imagine there may be a bit of fearfulness with that as well. Something as big and bold as this.
Well, it's more that Toronto has a bit of a history of, you know, talking about things and making big plans without necessarily following through with them. So I think that a lot of us are just sort of excited to see something this big with, you know, it looks like there's a bit of momentum behind it. And it does tie in with, you know, some of the other plans that are floating around the redevelopment of that sort of former industrial section of our waterfront. So it looks like this could actually have legs. So I think that's sort of where a lot of the excitement is coming from on this.
Well, tell us a little bit about your background and kind of where you fit into this world of creating better places.
Yeah, well, I guess I've got a background in architecture and urban design. And for the past number of years, I've been working primarily with Toronto's public space. And Toronto's at a pretty interesting sort of stage of our growth or time period or whatever you want to call it, because we're one of the lucky cities in that people want to live here and our population's growing at quite an astonishing rate. And our population's growing specifically in the downtown of our city. Obviously, you know, in the outlying areas as well, but, you know, we're not... The growth isn't being led by sort of the suburbs and the inner suburbs. A lot of people are, you know, moving to the downtown and wanting to live as well as work in the downtown. And we're, you know, looking at very high-level planning documents that are in place, like the official plan that sort of, you know, everything else sort of filters down from that. Growth is being specifically directed to the downtown, to the sort of local centers. Like, I don't know if you know Toronto as it is today is sort of an amalgamation that happened in the 1990s of the former city of Toronto with Etobicoke to the west, North York to the north, and Scarborough to the east. So each of those three former autonomous cities has a center. So our growth is being directed to the downtown of the former city of Toronto, which is now the main downtown of the amalgamated city, to the sort of local centers of those three cities, and also to the sort of main avenues throughout the city. So it's pretty exciting seeing, you know, that growth being directed there, but it also means that, you know, we're seeing an influx of population into what are already our, you know, most dense or most intensely developed areas. So that's putting, you know, understandable pressure on, you know, a whole number of things, you know, in those areas, including sort of the infrastructure from sort of sewers to transit to our public space infrastructure, which is what interests me and interests us at the Laneway Project, is seeing how we can sort of rethink our existing infrastructure that's already publicly owned and make that work for, you know, the growing and changing population of the city.
Interesting. Do you think that kind of the planning documents and the government processes that are kind of in place with those, are they able to keep up with the rapid speed of development in these areas?
They've been historically, they've been a bit lagging recently. They've started to actually do a pretty good job. We've got some long overdue, I should say, upgrades happening to our transit system. We've recently had a pilot project start on King Street, one of the main thoroughfares through downtown, to actually prioritize transit along that corridor. It's the busiest streetcar route in the city. It gets 60,000 people using the streetcar every day versus 20,000 using the road in cars. And so that the city's running a pilot project for the next year to actually prioritize transit in that space, which is something that, you know, even a few years ago we would never even thought would be considered in the city. So it's, yeah, there seems to be sort of a recognition sort of at all scales, at all levels, that, you know, we've reached a bit of a tipping point with our growth, and you know, we can start thinking creatively about, you know, that infrastructure from sort of how we get through the city to how we sort of live in the city.
Interesting. Do you find that these newcomers, that there's a that's a generally positive trend, or is there a fear associated with those newcomers, or how does that core of Toronto that's been around for years kind of feel about this new development happening?
Yeah, we actually it's been, you know, as far as I can see, taken as a broadly positive thing by people, by sort of existing Torontonians, if you will. You know, because we're a thriving city. You know, obviously, you know, there are people in the city struggling as well. I shouldn't, you know, paint a completely rosy picture of the city, but we're a city that's doing quite well. And I don't think that people feel threatened by more people coming to the city. You know, people largely seem to see this as a positive thing, and you know, something that adds, you know, vitality to the city. There has been a bit of tension recently in how that growing population is being housed. You know, we've seen a lot of sort of identical or near identical sort of condos going up, and that's been sort of far and away the primary way that intensification or additional housing has been, you know, being added and has been happening in the city. And there's been, over the past few years, you know, pushback against that sort of one-size-fits-all solution to adding new living space in the city. So that it hasn't been so much a pushback against the fact that we're growing, but there's been a bit of pushback against the way that it's happening.
Interesting. Which I imagine your work is then becoming even more pressing in some ways as this development continues. And I'm wondering, you know, I think that many of us that have been in the field for a while kind of understand the value of publicly owned space and thinking about it creatively. And I wonder, from your guys' perspective, what, when you're couching the value proposition around rethinking public spaces, how do you kind of propose that to people that aren't as familiar with the field?
So what we sort of say, particularly in the context of laneways, is that, and the reason we started working on them, is that, you know, there's a vast number of them in precisely the area of Toronto where population growth is being directed. So sort of the pre-1930s part of the city, basically the part of the city that was built when stuff still needed mucking out, and it was better to be doing that via a back laneway rather than the street. So there's sort of a happy confluence of, you know, where growth is sort of very visible and is being felt very, you know, very strongly by people, and, you know, these laneways. And up until very, very recently, laneways, sort of similarly to a lot of different types of urban space, have been thought of as sort of a one thing only, you know, that they're service only spaces, and that's the way they are no matter the time of day, the day of week, you know, the month, the season, whatever. And I think that there's, it's been interesting in that there's been an appreciation sort of as our population does grow and as, you know, we're being housed in, you know, smaller and smaller units without access to sort of private outdoor space beyond a little balcony, there's been a recognition of the fact that, okay, well, we need to think a little differently about the way that we're using the shared parts of our city, the public spaces, so the streets, the parks, the laneways, the squares, because as our population does grow in these denser areas, there's increasing demand for those spaces, increasing need for those to act as, you know, multi-use, multi-user spaces.
Interesting. Well, I, just as a backtrack, I think I'm familiar from looking at your stuff what a laneway is, but for those of us that use slightly different language, it's essentially an alleyway. Is it? That's what we call it.
Absolutely. Okay. It's basically the little street that runs sort of mid-block between the big streets is how I always describe it to people. It's, you know, there in Toronto, there are over 2,400 of them, and they're all publicly owned. There are we were working with a recent grad from Ryerson University recently, and, you know, he ran an analysis, and there's approximately 6 private laneways in Toronto, but there's a whole lot of 2,400 public ones. And they range in width between 3 and 6 meters. So they're quite a bit narrower, than the sort of usual street. But they cover more than 250 kilometers in length. So that's, you know, when you start thinking of that as a web throughout our urban fabric, you know, that touches pretty well all of our downtown and midtown neighborhoods in the city. And, you know, as you say, laneway, alley, they were sort of, you know, conceived and put in place as being sort of secondary access to properties off the main streets themselves.
Well, it's really interesting for me to see that you guys are focusing energy there, and it makes a lot of sense to me, although I will say that I was talking to one of my colleagues about coming on here with you, and they were saying, well, good luck, the alleyways are just alleyways. And I was like, That's exactly the kind of thinking that you guys are trying to overcome in some ways.
For sure. That's something that we used to hear more. I often get the question of, you know, have we come up against any sort of opposition to what we're doing? And I would say, you know, not really, just because of what I was talking about before, the sort of recognition that Toronto's growing and we need to rethink things. What we do hear is sort of a nervousness. You know, people are nervous that we're proposing eliminating their vehicular access to their garage, or that, you know, they're no longer going to be able to take deliveries in the laneways or anything like that. So we often, you know, sort of nip that in the bud by starting out when we're speaking, you know, when we're invited into a community to, you know, speak about the laneways and about the possibilities there. We often start out by saying that, you know, we are not proposing pedestrianizing the laneway, eliminating vehicular access, or anything like that. Because we actually ran some stats, and when you look at the amount of time that the laneways are in use for those service functions, things like deliveries, garbage pickup, parking access, things like that. And, you know, all of that's absolutely essential, but it only takes up, depending on, you know, the type of neighborhood, whether it's more of a commercial neighborhood or a residential one, you know, 5 to maximum about 15% of their time is taken up with that. So, you know, I always sort of preempt any concerns that people have by sort of letting them know that, you know, there's a whole lot of scope for improvement of the space and, you know, tweaks to the space to turn them into spaces that work for service but also work for pedestrians and cyclists, and, you know, that are also a bit, you know, softer and greener, and things that can be done that that have absolutely no bearing on, you know, whether or not a vehicle can access that laneway. You know, you think of putting, you know, pedestrian-friendly lighting in there. Well, you know, that doesn't block the right of way. You know, a car or a delivery truck can still get through. Similarly, there are species of vine that, you know, you can grow on your facade without danger of sort of damaging the facade materials. Well, growing a vine up the wall of a building adjacent to a laneway. Well, that doesn't block a delivery truck getting into that laneway, but it makes the laneway a nicer space to be in for all users. So that's sort of usually how we approach sort of the one sort of main concern that we have heard from people.
Well, I think that there are two certain kind of trends that you guys are at the center of. One being, you know, this idea that as space becomes more precious and as we envision what urban space should be, that multiple use becomes very important in some ways, doesn't it?
Yeah, sorry, I've got some noise in the background here. Can you repeat the question?
Well, just that you guys seem to be at the center of this kind of move to understand that the more that we can take urban space and make it available for multiple uses, kind of the better in many ways.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that's sort of the key for me. It's not necessarily that any of our spaces are as a whole overlooked, but I think that what's commonly overlooked is that spaces can be multiple things. They can have multiple functions. They can serve multiple users. And I think that's sort of the great untapped resource that we have in our cities, just thinking, you know, what else a street can do, or what else a park can do, or what else a laneway can do. And I think that when you start sort of changing your thinking around these spaces like that, you actually open up a whole lot of possibilities that can really, you know, enhance the neighborhood that space is in.
Are there other examples that come to mind of places that we've often think about of having one use that could have more than one? For me, kind of the immediate successor to what you guys are doing, or we see this new revitalization of rooftops that seems to be.
I'm programming director at.
You there, Michelle?
Oh yeah, definitely. You know, spaces that aren't immediately thought of as sort of green spaces, but you know, if you look at an aerial view of the city, of course, so much of the surface area, so to speak, that you see from the air is rooftop. And when, you know, changing that from being, you know, just asphalt roof to being, you know, green roof, even if it's just, you know, the really low growing moss, that has a big effect on, you know, the environment of the city, reduces the heat island effect, you know, helps a little bit with stormwater absorption and things like that. You know, so that's a big one. And another one is looking at the streets themselves, that, you know, at the moment they're designed predominantly for motorized vehicles. That there are times of the week and times of the year where there's actually quite low motorized vehicle traffic. And so we have a project here in Toronto called Open Streets TO. And it's called, you know, other things in different cities, like New York has Summer Streets, there's Ciclovia elsewhere. But basically the idea is that for, you know, in a pop-up way, so for, you know, a few hours every week, or, you know, once a month every summer or whatever, that the spaces, the streets are turned into car-free recreational spaces, specifically at the times of week where they're already seeing the lowest vehicular traffic. And that often coincides with the time of the week when the majority or the sort of largest number of people are off work or on their weekends. And so there's sort of proportionally the highest demand for that recreational space. So that's, you know, another example of how we can, you know, without investing in any further capital infrastructure, we can, you know, we can increase the recreational infrastructure of the city, so to speak.
And this is particularly fascinating in some ways, I think, when you're talking about the laneways and the streets, because those are publicly owned spaces. And so there's this weird dynamic of you as non-governmental actors trying to figure out how to use these publicly owned spaces some way when government is not necessarily have the time or energy to deal with all these spaces. So how do you kind of view the role of government in doing this? Is it more facilitating people like yourselves, or do they need to be kind of more active in this as well?
Well, I mean, it's not a one-size-fits-all solution. I mean, it varies by city, right? There are, you know, there are cities like, you know, Melbourne in Australia, you know, Montreal, Vancouver, where specifically from the laneways front, the city has taken sort of more of a a driving role in, in transforming those spaces. But that's not necessarily, what's going to work in every city. And sort of the way things work here in Toronto, it certainly seems that the first option that you mentioned seems to work best. And we've certainly found, on each of our projects, we work, hand in hand with, decision makers at City Hall, both at the political and at the staff level. Also people in the, business and retail community, with universities, with community members. And sort of the approach that we take is that each of those groups, brings a different set of sort of experience, capabilities, skill set, and perspectives to the table. And we need to get them all working together to make a public space project actually go forward, both on the implementation, but crucially on the ongoing sort of sustainability of that project on the stewardship level, to make sure that it's something that continues to work and be able to adapt with the needs of the city. So that's sort of the way that we've been working with the city here in Toronto, and it's been working quite well for us, I think, in terms of, we'll work on locally specific projects with local stakeholders, including the local BIAs or business improvement associations, neighborhood associations, civic groups, you name it, to, assess and transform a specific space. But we also keep city staff apprised of, what we're doing the whole time, and work with them to figure out, within the regulatory framework of the city, how can we do this? And how does this work? And then, we communicate with them afterwards to sort of share lessons learned, and to look at, how we can make this kind of thing easier in the future. And we've actually seen a number of policy changes here in Toronto that we've consulted on, and that sort of stem from, certainly in part from some of the lessons that we've learned doing these community-level demonstration projects. And I think for us, the key has been to sort of do stuff locally, but also always have that sort of macro level view of, how does this fit into the overall framework of what's going on in the city.
We'd like to take a moment now to say thank you to our sponsors today. The Urban Affairs and Planning Program at Virginia Tech School of Public and International Affairs offers an interdisciplinary approach to understanding planning and policy for megaregions, cities, suburbs, and rural regions in the U.S. and abroad. UAP faculty have expertise in urban planning, architecture, urban design, economics, geography, political science, law, technology, and engineering, and provide students with a multifaceted understanding of how communities grow and change. Students apply their knowledge and professional skills by participating in real-world problem-solving with community clients through project-based studios and applied research. UAP emphasizes technical analysis and policy evaluation in approaching the complexities of modern communities. So a big thanks today to the Urban Affairs and Planning Program down at Virginia Tech for being our sponsor. If you'd like to hear more, check them out online. But without further ado, we'll get back to today's guest. Thank you. I'm interested. You mentioned all of these different kind of partners and organizations and individuals coming to the table, and I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you guys go about creating shared vision, even if just for a short period of time, to work on this one project. How you guys go about doing that?
Well, we sort of approach it, I guess, a little bit differently with the different sort of stakeholder groups or people with skin in the game, so to speak, that I talked about earlier. But I mean, fundamentally, it comes down to, when we're coordinating, collaborating with people that are sort of at the local level, that know the space very intimately, the people that live in the neighborhood, work in a neighborhood, run civic groups in a neighborhood or whatever. We always just, we start with very simple, and I shouldn't, not simple as in like that they're, it's dumbed down, but simple as in just really basic questions. What's working here? What's not working here? What do you want to see here? What do you not want to see here? And it's then our role as planners and urban designers to sort of translate what we hear back into sort of urban design and planning terms and into sort of implementable actions that can address, you know, what we hear from the community. And that's where we work in coordination with staff at the City of Toronto to sort of, you know, make sure that when we're translating things into urban design and planning terms, that those things fit within the regulatory framework of the City of Toronto. And where there aren't, because this is very often the case with laneways, where there aren't, you know, regulations or best practices established for how to do a certain thing in a laneway, because until very recently, they've been largely off the radar. We work with city staff at that point to sort of figure out, okay, well, you know, if we wanted to do this, you know, what are the red lines that we mm-hmm. need to sort of work within? And then we sort of work to establish, and we, you know, work along with the community and the city to establish a new sort of best practice precedent for how to do a given thing. And then following that, we work with the city to sort of try to solidify that into policy at the city level.
That's fascinating, because it's, you know, in some ways it's clear that listening and being a good listener is as important a skill as some of the technical sides of things of what
Definitely.
You're doing.
Definitely.
Do you find that, you know, that I imagine the trust is an absolutely crucial part of what you guys are doing as well.
Absolutely. And it's really important, you know, for us, because, you know, we're planners and urban designers, you know, we have experience with community facilitation and everything. So we have a certain set of skills, but, you know, we're not omnipotent. And it's very important that, you know, that we make it clear, you know, obviously not necessarily in those exact words, but we make it very clear off the bat when we start working with the community that we realize that we're not omnipotent. We realize that we have a certain skill set, and we're there to work with them to hopefully, you know, with a combination of our two sets of knowledge and skill sets or whatever, you know, their local level knowledge, their knowledge of what works in their neighborhood, and our ability to sort of translate that and connect that to the sort of more official level language that, you know, together we can make this work, but you know, we can't make it work on our own. They can't make it work on their own. So let's develop a partnership and let's work together to do this. And that's especially since, you know, I'm sure it's the same down where you are, that for the past number of decades, there's been the tendency with sort of the way that planning and urban design and architecture has been done, for a sort of professional to ride in and sort of say what's going to happen in a community. And so part of what we find that's really important when we go in and start working with a community is to establish that that's not going to be the way that we work. Often, you know, well, more so when we first started sort of 3.5-4 years ago, we would be asked at the beginning of, you know, a community visioning session, so where's the plan? What are we commenting on? And, you know, we would say, well, there isn't a plan. We're coming with an opportunity because your BIA has asked us in, and, you know, we want to hear from you about what should happen here. So that's been, you know, really key part of the approach, is sort of establishing that, you know, that we're working a little bit differently than people are used to.
I'm also kind of wondering that I think that, you know, part of what you guys do is in this getting people to think outside the box and increasing, you know, imaginative capacity in some ways. And I'm wondering, you know, you often must go into these neighborhoods and they're saying, well, whatever you did in this other neighborhood, we'd like to do that. Or can we have the same thing, the same amenity that we've seen in other places? And how do you get people to kind of, you know, take a step back and realize that they can do anything and to kind of come up with their own solutions and think even bigger than they wouldn't normally be accustomed to thinking about things?
Absolutely. And that's really important. And we try to address that partly with sort of starting with the sort of basic assessment of the space, as in, you know, what's working, what's not. And then we talk about, you know, the potential tools in the toolkit that we can use to address that. So sometimes people's approach is saying, hey, you know, I really liked that permeable paving project that you did in Willowvale Lane, for example. And, you know, we'll sort of step back and sort of work with them and say, okay, well, you know, what are the issues in your lane? Because if, you know, if there's not a drainage issue, a permeable paving project is quite expensive and is not necessarily the best allocation of resources, so to speak, in your lane. Although, you know, it's important sort of as an entry point that, you know, often it's what, you know, a given, you know, intervention or improvement in another laneway is often what sort of gets people thinking that, hey, you know, the laneway in our neighborhood, or the laneway behind my house, or the laneway behind my business, doesn't have to stay the way it is today. So that's a really important starting point. But yeah, we often try to go back to first principles, so to speak, in a neighborhood, and often, you know, that on its own gets people thinking about the other possibilities. And sometimes we also will start by showing precedent examples from elsewhere and just a whole range of different things that have been done in neighborhoods and cities elsewhere. And we're always careful to pick, you know, neighborhoods or cities, sort of urban fabrics that are comparable to Toronto so that people can see the applicability of the given precedent. But we're always careful to show, you know, a really wide range of possibilities because, you know, in the hopes that that sort of opens people's minds and gets them thinking about, you know, the further potential in their neighborhood.
Do you think that in some ways the work that you guys are doing by encouraging them to rethink this, you know, which what is in some ways a fairly small part of their neighborhood in this laneway, is part of teaching them to think more broadly and more creatively about solutions for everything that they see in their neighborhoods?
Definitely. And I think a big part of it is sort of not taking the current, you know, situation or space or, you know, the current way things are as set in stone. Realizing that, you know, they are the way they are. There are things that, you know, are easier or more difficult to change, but everything is in principle changeable. You know, if there's, you know, a compelling reason for it to change. And obviously if it aligns with, you know, other initiatives that are going on and, you know, it's not open season, but but in principle, you know, everything can change and it sort of pays to think about spaces in terms of, yeah, the possibilities and yeah, what are some of the improvements that could be made?
Is there difficulty sometimes in getting people to think this way and that they keep coming back to that, or that they don't feel like maybe they have permission to think about these bigger things, or that they don't, they've never been asked to be part of this kind of change and they don't feel capable of it? Is that something you guys see often?
We've thought that we would see it more often than we have. I think that it's been helpful, sort of the way we've positioned ourselves as sort of, you know, a third party or sort of connective tissue, so to speak, between the community and the official level. I think that that sort of helps people. I mean, we definitely have worked in communities that historically have seen, you know, underinvestment. They haven't, you know, been really engaged with civic processes or sort of the official level processes of the city, and definitely, you know, even in those communities, even sometimes getting people to come out to, you know, community workshops to look at the public space, that's sort of been a challenge. Once people do come out, it's been a bit easier to sort of, you know, spark their imagination, get them to sort of give ideas. Once people do come out, they're usually quite ready to do that. But yeah, I guess that's sort of the biggest obstacle that we've had is when we're working in communities that say the residents association invites us in, but we want to make sure that, you know, everyone in the neighborhood that wants to has the opportunity to participate. It's been often a challenge connecting with everyone in the neighborhood, especially in communities that historically have been, you know, more disengaged from official level processes. So I guess, yeah, that's probably been our major challenge.
It's interesting because I think that, you know, it's definitely a challenge because I'm imagining when you're creating these spaces or you're creating these alleyways, you're wanting them to be a reflection of the community that they're part of, and that, you know, in some ways it becomes a real issue if people or members of that community don't feel like that work that you're doing reflects who they are as a community.
Absolutely. And I guess the way that we try to sort of avoid that is by making sure that the plan and the interventions that are got in place are, you know, they're not micromanaging the space. They're not setting up the space to be one thing only. I often sort of say that, you know, communities know what they want to do in their public spaces. We just need to get the framework in place to enable them to sort of do that. So, you know, putting things, you know, like lighting, like greening measures, like, you know, proper paving and, you know, even unsexy things like proper waste management, you know, practices and laneways and stuff like that, getting that sort of, you know, underlying framework in place, hopefully leaves enough flexibility that the, you know, people can sort of use the space in, you know, any number of ways, in ways that, you know, we can't even imagine now, you know, in 10, 15 years, who knows how people are going to want to use the space, but hopefully we get a robust, you know, underlying framework in place that enables that. And that's, yeah, as I say, that's how we sort of tried to address the fact that, you know, we can't reach every single person in that neighborhood.
Well, I mean, you know, I was really struck as you were talking there about this idea of use, and that the idea of that things need to be used in some ways. And I think that that's a really compelling thing, and that you mentioned that, you know, less than 5 or 10% of the time these laneways or alleyways are used, and, you know, there's a truth that when you go into a community that their parks are not being used or that their downtown squares are not being used, it really can set a tone that's quite negative in many ways, can't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's sort of, it can snowball either way. You know, there's the broken window syndrome. So when a space is visibly not cared for, people are less inclined to care for it. But then it works the other way as well. When a space is visibly owned and cared for by a community, people are less inclined to, you know, disrespect it, so to speak. So I think the key is getting that snowball rolling in the correct direction. Because then that becomes, to an extent, you know, a sustainable or self-sustaining thing.
Well, you've mentioned a little bit that you guys often will have these conversations and do a project, and then that winds up needing some policy-related work that comes with it. And I wonder kind of how you balance those needs for policy change, which is often, you know, maybe the longer term impact of things, and then project based work, which is maybe more of that imaginative capacity building. How do you kind of marry those and understand how those two work together?
Yeah, I guess because laneways have been to an extent a policy blank spot in the city of Toronto, we have an interesting opportunity to actually start with the demonstration projects, because often it's not that there's policy saying that you can't do what we want to do, but just there's not policy around it. So we often have the opportunity to use the local level, you know, collaborative, you know, community level demonstration projects to work out how to do things, and to work out, you know, if and where there are, you know, often unintended policy blockages that prevent certain things from happening. And, you know, we then, at the end of a project, we do a bit of a sort of debrief with ourselves to sort of figure out, okay, well, you know, what worked well here, you know, what could maybe be improved on the policy level. And then, you know, we've been really careful throughout our work to always, you know, try to maintain, you know, positive and open relations with people at City Hall, you know, both on the technical staff level and also on the political level. So we then, you know, we'll reach out to people in the relevant city division after the project, or often we'll sort of go to them about a group of projects so that we're not, you know, harassing them every month or so. but to sort of talk about some of the things that we found have been, you know, impediments to what we're trying to do, and to sort of just have an open, you know, friendly conversation with them about, you know, whether there are ways that these things can maybe change.
It's fascinating to see kind of that open dialogue that you guys have been able to maintain, because I do think that, you know, here in the States, we find it that these questions become increasingly politicized, even when we see no reason that they should become politicized. And it's, you know, it's great to see that you guys have been able to keep that positive relationship going.
Yeah, it's been so essential to how we work, and, you know, on the, you know, the relationship with people at City Hall, but also that positive relationship with, you know, people at the community level. I think that the most important thing to maintaining those positive relations has been just being really open and transparent with how we work, so that people know that, you know, so to speak, what they see is what they get. You know, what we're saying is what we're actually doing. And that we're always really transparent with how we arrive at the different, you know, the different elements of a plan, or, you know, for instance, we're in early 2018, we're going to put out a document of 8 no-brainers for Toronto's laneways. And this is not stuff that we've dreamed up ourselves. And, you know, we're really clear in the introduction to the document that these are things that have been brought up unprompted by us in every single one of the 25 plus communities that we've worked in so far. And so when we sort of present our work and sort of communicate things in that way, we found that it's really, you know, important and positive in terms of, you know, maintaining those good and open relations with the different sort of levels and scales of stakeholders that we're working with.
Well, I'm intrigued that I imagine that you've visited a number of different cities and been in different places, even within Toronto and beyond. But when you're visiting a new place, and do you just go immediately to the alleyways, or what are the kind of indicators that you look for that a community is vital and using space well and just moving in the right direction?
Well, I always like to do a lot of walking wherever I visit. So unless it's, you know, going to be about a 4-hour walk somewhere, I'd like to sort of walk between A and B and C. Because then I find that, you know, you're experiencing the city at, you know, a bit of a slower pace and actually getting to, you know, to obviously in a superficial way as a visitor, but, you know, getting to sort of observe in a better way sort of how it's working. And for me, what sort of indicates that a place is working well is when, you know, when spaces are busy, when people are sort of using a space in a variety of ways. So people are moving through it, but people are also sort of, you know, hanging out. There may be, you know, they're going to a shop, they're, you know, they're sitting under a tree, they're talking to people, they're people watching, just that there are a number of different possible ways to use a given space, because that starts to indicate that it's a space that's going to be appealing to a larger number of people. It's going to have sort of something to offer to a larger number of people. And you can, when sort of on the flip side, you can see that a space is not necessarily working when people seem only to be hurrying through it, or when there's no one in it at all. So I think that sort of just observing the people in the space is sort of the best way to gauge how healthy it is.
Fascinating. Do you? It's amazing how many times I ask that question and people come back with walking and walkability or any of those kinds of things. But it's fascinating, especially because I imagine a lot of times when you're visiting a new place, you're coming into an airport, which is a totally often distant place from the rest of the city in many ways.
Yeah, not the nicest journey often between the airport and the center or the sort of midtown area of the city.
Well, I wonder, as we kind of start to close up, if you can share, as someone who's worked in this field for a little while now, what's something that maybe you learned along the way that surprised you, or something that you didn't necessarily think you'd be thinking was so important at this point?
I think the importance of acknowledging the limits of your own knowledge. Because when you're going through architecture school or urban design school, you're going through a lot of programs at university. You're sort of taught that you are the expert, so to speak. And I guess working in a sort of collaborative, community-centered way, you come to realize how important it is to just acknowledge and be open about the fact that you know certain things and you don't know other things. Because that starts to break down the wall around you or the facade, so to speak. I guess that's been not necessarily surprising, because that seems kind of obvious that would be the case, but I guess that's the thing that has been the biggest departure from my training, to put it that way.
Well, I can certainly see it. And I think that, there's a really difficult but vital sense of humility that has to come with this as well, that, that there's, embracing the fact that you don't know, while also sharing there are certain important things that you do know, that's important to share as well, isn't it?
Absolutely. And to be honest, if you're honest about what you don't know, people will believe you when you tell them that you do know something, because they know that you're willing to admit when you don't know. So if you're saying you know something, they'll believe you. They'll say, okay, well, she probably actually does know that then, because she's saying she does.
Well, very cool. And I wonder if you could kind of close us off then with a story of what happens when a community works well, or what a community that's working well looks like.
I think a community that's working well has variety and is adaptable, and it's going to give you a bit of a different experience every time you go to it, or every time you go out in it, or whatever. That it's not somewhere that's the same all the time. It's not somewhere that is used by the same group of people all the time. Thinking of an example, a residential community that we worked in here in Toronto, in Little Portugal. We worked with them to develop a master plan of their laneway, and following that, and this was stuff that no one had even mentioned during the master planning process, but they started having community movie nights in the laneway. They had community potlucks in the space, and I guess a community that's working well is a community where people feel comfortable getting out and using the space of their community, and where people evidently feel sort of competent and empowered to do things in their community.
Fascinating. And in some ways that when you go out and you find something different, something surprising, that's welcomed in some ways, because I can imagine that being a very threatening thing in some ways as well.
Yeah. So that when you can see that, that's the way that community operates, and that, people welcome that. Because then that starts, maybe that indicates a community where sort of people are, welcome and included.
Oh, if only every community could be that way.
Well, I'm sure every community has a nugget of that in it.
That's very true. Well, thank you so much for taking the time, Michelle. I wonder if people are interested in learning more about what you guys do. Where can they find more information out about that?
Well, they can find us online at thelanewayproject.ca, and they can find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Laneway Project.
Well, wonderful. And if you guys are interested in learning more about CityWorks Expo, you can find us at cityworksexpo.com. But thank you again so much for taking the time today, Michelle.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Big Ideas for Better Places podcast today. If you like what you hear, please subscribe and leave a rating. It really helps other people find out about our fascinating guests and find the information that we have to share. Lastly, please save the date for our upcoming event, October 5th through 7th in Roanoke, Virginia. And keep up to date by following us on Facebook and checking out our website, cityworksexpo.com. That's cityworksexpo.com. thank you guys again and look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you.